Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this video lecture series of Wireless Cellular and 4G LTE. Module number 5, lecture number 3 on Radio Resource Management and Mobility Management. So in our previous video lecture, we have seen how this radio resource management is helpful in LTE 4G system. In our previous video lecture, we have also seen how this protocol stack of layer 2 is helpful in providing the effective quality of services. So today, in today's lecture, we will see how the various sub layers of PDCP protocol will help in LTE optimization and in header compression. So if you look at the sub layers of LTE layer 2, it consists of the various sub blocks like sequence number, header compression, ciphering, and added PDCP header. So we will see how this header compression is done and what is the use of doing the header compression. First of all, the header compression protocol, it's a protocol. You know what you mean by the protocol is nothing but these are the set of rules which are usually associated with the internet, that is internet protocol. Similarly, we have some set of rules related to LTE. Okay, so the very first here is the header compression protocol, which is used in LTE, and that is based on robust header compression. There is one framework we define here in LTE. It is called as ROHC, that is header, robust header compression technique. Okay, and this technique has been defined by Internet Engineering Task Force. It is also called as IETF. So this PDCP protocol or this PDCP entity, which has been subdivided into the user plane and the control plane, based on this user plane and control plane, the both the planes have the header compression. The what is it is one of the important block of the PDCP protocol or PDCP entity. So if you look at here, this head in header compression, this PDCP entities, they are configured by the upper layers. As we have seen in the OSI model, we have 7-layer model. So the first layer model, first layer is the application layer, if you take it from top to bottom. Similarly, in PDCP entity, these are being configured using the upper layers. Okay, and why we need to go for configuration is just to see that the performance of the LTE system is done in a proper way. But if you want to go for the header compression in LTE system, then you may require some kind of requirement or some services in LTE. Okay, so the very first service which is being provided in this particular LTE are, they are IP based. And you remember, this IP based is usually it's a data packet or it's a packet switching type of network. So this LTE makes use of packet switching network. So the service which is being provided by LTE is also based on IP based. And other than that, it is also based on the framework of IP and other related IETF protocols. Then, since this IP framework is native to the internet and provides the most cost effective mechanism for delivery of high bandwidth data, which is determined by 3GPP, that is the optimum choice for LTE. So what we have seen in the previous lecture, this PDCP protocol, which consists of both user plane and the data plane, this user and data plane has some kind of requirement. So the basic requirement here is they are the IP based, and they are also related to this IETF protocol. And the one more thing, what here this header compression focuses, it focuses on the cost effective mechanism for delivery of high bandwidth data. For example, if we have the data which is of in terms of kilobits, in terms of megabits, in terms of gigabits, right? And if you want to go for the transmission, then if you have a very low bandwidth of data, then it becomes very difficult for the framework to transmit the data over the internet. So therefore, as our LTE 4G systems makes use of very high bandwidth data transmission, therefore they are very cost effective. It means with a very low cost, the information can be delivered in a proper way. And how this is determined? This is determined by making use of your 3GPP choice. Okay, and these protocols, okay, are a significant amount of header overhead at the network layer. We have seen the IP datagram. In that particular IP datagram, if you look, we have all the seven layer, that is physical, data, network, transport layer, right? Then session layer, presentation, and application layer. So among all these seven layer, this LTE system, it gives us the significant amount of header overhead at the network layer, that is in IP, and in transport layer, if you make use of your TCP/IP protocol, or it can be your UDP protocol. And the other is the application layer, which contains the redundant and repetitive information and unnecessary consumes the precious radio resources. So whenever you go for any design of the network, you should make sure that there should not be any unnecessary consumption of the radio resources. Therefore, just to overcome the problems of this radio resources or the allocation of resources, these protocols should be, they should have some significant amount of header length or significant amount of header overhead. Then the other thing here in header compression is an efficient scheme is required. Okay, what do you mean by the efficient scheme is nothing but the services which are provided by the LTE services, it should be purely IP related. And then it should have some repetition in the header field such that the actual speech packets, whatever we get transmit, it should be received properly at the receiver side. Then apart from this service which has been provided by the header compression, there are some multiple header compression algorithms can also be used, and they are called as profiles, and they can also be defined for this ROHC framework. And each profile, what they have the specific to particular network layer, then transport layer, and some upper layer protocol combination. It can be either separate, like it can be with respect to the network, it can be with the transport, or any combination of these two. Okay, you can take an example, like you can mix up with the TCP/IP, okay, and it can be with RTP or UDP, or it can be IP also. Okay, so based on the combination of this, we define the term called as profiles. And what are the profiles? Profiles are the multiple header compression algorithms. So we try to write the algorithm for the header compression. Okay, it can be single, it can be multiple. Okay, so if you go for multiple, then you may end up with the combination of the different various protocol mechanisms. And this type of the combination or the separate type of mechanism of header compression profiles, they are usually used in 3GPP release 8. Okay, so if you look at into the table 10.3, we will come to know how this can be done. This is the very important block of the PDCB protocol. Either it can be in terms of control plane, or it can be in terms of user plane. The very second important block of the PDCP here is, it is integrating and ciphering. So yesterday we have seen how this ciphering is done. This ciphering and deciphering is done both in user plane and as well as in the control plane. Okay, and along with that, there is the another block is called as integrity. So here the integrity is refers to the type of security or kind of a protection to the data. Okay, so how this can be done is, the security related functions related to PDCP, they include the integrity protection and the ciphering. Okay, and the very large amount of this PDCP or the PDO, they are being denoted by a parameter called as a count. Okay, and they are being maintained and used in the input to security algorithm. For example, if I develop one security algorithm, then I will try to maintain the count of that particular integrity and ciphering, how much my count should be. Okay, and for that particular count, we will be having some format, okay, which is shown in figure number 10.7. So if you look at into the figure number 10.7, we will come to know how this format can be used and how this format can be used in this integrity and ciphering. So other than this, the another important part of the ciphering and integrity is the length of this format is been 32 bits. okay, and it consists of two parts. First part is the hyperframe number, it is denoted by HFN, and the other is the PDCP SN. Here SN represents my sequence number, and based on the sequence number used, the reordering and the duplicate detection of RLC packet at the receiver end is possible. If you want to go for the ordering, like giving some number and making it duplicate, sometimes in the network there is a possibility that the transmitted data can be made duplicate and then can be detected also. Okay, so by making use of these two parts, one is hyperframe number and the another is PDCP sequence number, your reordering and duplication can be detected at the receiver end, not at the transmitter end. So looking at to the table number 10.3, which is discussed here in the header compression, it says that this table header compression has the various profiles. So if you look at this table, we have a profile ID. Okay, profile ID is nothing but one ID will be assigned to one particular protocol or one particular data, okay, or it can be a user. Okay, so based on that particular ID, it will show you the usage in the sense whether there is any kind of a compression happening, okay, or whether it is a single compression or whether it is a combination of two profiles. Okay, what we have seen here, okay, you can see here the profiles are nothing but they are the algorithms, right? So based on the algorithms, we are trying to merge either one, or it can be two, or it can be in combination of any of this. Okay, so based on the profile ID, for example, if the profile ID is all zero, it means the no compression is being taken place in the user plane. Okay, and what is the reference for this? It is given by RFC 4995. And if I have a profile ID of 0001, then the usage is nothing but it can be RTP, UDP, and IP. And they have given some kind of references. So similarly, for different profile IDs, there will be a different usage. So based on the usage, they define the reference number or reference value. And what is the another use of this integrity and ciphering is, this integrity protection, it includes both the protection of your data and the verification of your data. Okay, and it is being performed only on the control plane, not in the data plane, or simply can call not on the user plane. Okay, so we have seen basically the PDCP has two plane, control and the user. So this type of integrity and ciphering, they are done in the control plane, not in the user plane. Then the data unit that is the integrity protected, it is PDU header. We have seen yesterday what the PDU headers, in PDU header we have data, another is the control. Okay, so this is been done in the PDU header and the data part of PDU before ciphering. So before ciphering, you need to try to protect the header, and header consists of the information. Okay, some information which is required for the transmission, or it can be required for the reception also. Okay, and based on this integrity protection, you have the one more field called as medium access control version 1, which is also of a 32-bit. Okay, and at the transmission side, the value of MAC field is calculated based on the key provided by the RRC. Okay, once you study the concept of network security, okay, there comes the topic of encryption and decryption. And if you want to go for encryption, you require a specific key. Okay, and that The other thing which we have seen here is nothing but the protection of integrity. Okay, so I'll just repeat what we have done here is, so integration protection, it is done both at it includes both the integrity protection and the integrity verification, first thing. The second thing is, it has been protected by some value of PDU headers. Okay, and other than that, the integrity protection has been provided by the MAC field, which is of 32-bit. Okay, and before at the transmission, The value of the MAC field is calculated based on the key provided by the RRC, the radio receiver identifier. Okay, and I've told that we have a concept in the network security of encryption and decryption, where we will be having some kind of key. Either it can be public key or it can be a private key. So based on that key, we usually go for encryption and the decryption. Okay, so this is how we try to go for ciphering. Okay, the another name for encryption, we usually call it as a cipher. Okay, and the other thing here is, if you are at the receiver side, what the receiver should do? Okay, the receiver should compute the expected message authentication code on the received message using the same parameters and algorithm used by the sender. That is what, if you are doing some kind of encryption and if you are doing some kind of authentication and applying some kind of authentication rules or protocols at the transmitter side, then the same thing has to be done at the receiver side. It means that if you are using some key at the transmitter for encryption, then you should use the same key for the decryption or for the deciphering at the receiver also. That is what the concept of integrity and the verification is. Okay, and what happens if the two keys do not match? Okay, if they do not match, then this does not pass the integrity check. Okay, always there will be some kind of a check. Check in the sense whether the two keys are matching or not, or whether the two key or the two numbers or the two verification codes are matching or not matching. Based on that particular matching technique, okay, we go for the ensuring of our integrity or ensuring of our normal data or ensuring of how the protection can be increased. In this way, we try to protect. And if the two numbers or if the two keys or the if the two codes do not match, then by defaultly this PDCP will be discarded, or the information which has come at the receiver will be automatically get discarded. Okay, and the other thing here is, what we do in the ciphering is, the ciphering function includes both ciphering and deciphering. Okay, and it is performed both in the control plane as well as in the data plane. Okay, and for the control plane, the data unit is ciphered, is the data part of the PDCP, PDU, and the MAC one for the user plane. Okay, and based on this operation, how the ciphering is done is, ciphering is only done by using the XOR operation. That is the XOR, exclusive OR operation of the data unit with the ciphering stream. And this ciphering stream is generated by ciphering algorithm, or simply you can call it as an encryption algorithm based on ciphering keys. You can see they have mentioned the key. Okay, and it will also show the radio receiver barrier identity and the value of count. It will show how many times you are trying to cipher. One time, two time, three time. The more the number, the count, the stronger the type of encryption. Stronger the type of coding. Okay, so if it is more strong, then nobody can break that particular code. Okay, so that our whole system is completely encrypted. Okay, so in this way, we try to go for the ciphering and integrity. And they have shown one format here. This format in figure number 10.7 shows the format for the count. It is PDCP, that is the sequence number, and it is the HFN, that is the header number, which is the total is all about 32 bit. Okay, so in this way, we go for the integrity and ciphering of the data. Both it can be in the user plane or it can be at the control plane. With this, I conclude the today's lecture. Okay, thank you.